business in order to run a business smoothly. So Kirsten is by far the person that teaches others, and some of the most successful professionals like our mentors, Chris and Lori, about some of these strategies in how to optimize your business. So I think we're in a really, really good company, and I can't thank you enough for being here. I'm going to shut up and I'm going to hand it over to you.
Thank you so much, everybody. It's a pleasure to be here, like she said, on a Saturday morning. So I hope you guys are awake and ready. I'm going to go ahead and I will share my screen. Let's see. But while I'm doing that, I wanted to start off with asking a couple of questions to everybody. And as we're going to be going, it's going to be very interactive. So feel free to if you don't have a pen and paper or something to write down on, we're going to kind of stop throughout and do kind of little exercises, because I'm all about like just get it done right now kind of thing. So we're not going to get like super extensive, but I want you to like leave today with feeling like you are one step closer to being organized in your business. Does that sound good?
Yes.
Okay. So the first question I'm going to ask you all is, what is like my overall feeling of organization in my business? And you can rate yourself with just like the three happy faces. Like a green happy face is, or just like a smiley face is, I'm feeling good about it. I know I have opportunities for improvement, but you know, I feel good. Like the one like this is a, like, you know, I'm not happy, but the business is running. And then sad face is like, help, please, help me. And if you want to, you can go ahead and put in the chat how you're feeling. And you, if you don't want to put in the chat, if you don't want to say, you don't have to, but that's okay. Okay. And if you're feeling like this, most people feel like that. Okay. And now, and I'm all about, I love the concept of the one thing and essentialism, because I think multitasking is a myth. Yes, we have many things to do. You know, I'm not like, you know, there's many people that are moms and also, you know, on this board and that board. But at the end of the day, it's like, what is the priority? And when I say priority, I mean one thing, not priorities. Priority was never meant to refer to more than one thing. we kind of changed that about 100 years ago and said, what are your top priorities? It's like, that's not really how the word's supposed to work. But what is the priority that you are working towards in your business? And if you would like to go ahead and put that in the chat. And if it's loose, the more specific, the better. But if it's high level, that's fine. It's better to start with something than nothing at all. We are not striving for perfection here. Like she said, I am working with right now a $6 billion company annually. And the way they test and release things is insane. And if they're doing that, you know, small businesses have a much more opportunity to be agile than a big business, because you have to like tell Sharon in marketing, to tell Danny in operations, to tell all these people. So I want you guys to think that in your mind, that like build the airplane as we're going down the cliff. It may feel scary, but it's going to move you forward faster and help you uncover like where the problems are, what you like, what you don't like, what's working, what's not working. And really think about this as like organization. You will never be fully organized, because that's almost your perception of like perfection, right? And so just already know that there's always going to be things out of order. And if you kind of just have that intention and know that, but I will feel good about the things that matter most. And then I will know what is not essential and be okay with those maybe not having organization. Okay, so I'm going to go through the list over here. And FYI, I started my coffee and I yelled to my boyfriend, I'm like, make me finish the coffee. I need to have my coffee. So if you see like a hand coming in, that's him, by the way. Okay, so most people are feeling like not too good about organization. They're you know, it's because you're probably wearing all the hats, and that's normal. And also, if you are a small business owner, you are every role and responsibility. So like, when were we trained that? No, we weren't trained to do those types of things. Okay, so six-figure author, great, love that. Consistent workflow, wonderful organization. Okay, so I want to just look at this. Jasna, what do you mean about organization? That's what you're focusing on in your business.
This is my entire year. There's one word, is discipline and organization. I crank out a lot of content, but it's kind of all over the place. And I could be way more organized in how I process things, like basically having workflows and things. I've never really fully implemented that. Mm-hmm. So this is the year for it.
Wonderful. Now I want to challenge you and take you to the next question is the organization will lead me to do or feel what in my business and life? Because organization is just a means to an end. And so you wanna think about how can I measure the organization? So that's maybe I wanna have my team on processes for my social media outreach, so I don't need to worry about that. So I feel organized that, you know, that can be taken care of. Or it's, I feel organized that I have a consistent client workflow, so they, I'm guaranteeing this repeatable experience and have this quality of service that's consistent. Okay, consistent workflow. And I'm gonna challenge you, Ashley, the same thing. The consistent workflow will lead to what? What are you looking for that to lead you to? And maybe that's just my bad with I phrased it wrong get there. But I always want you to think end, and then we're going to back into it. Trying to motivate myself to pre-schedule things. Okay, so then I want you to think, I'm going to ask you, is it Maria?
Yes.
Why do you want to motivate yourself to pre-schedule things?
I'll turn on my video. I feel like I just sort of post haphazardly without any sort of eye on like engagement or if it's the right time. And mostly because like if I were to sit down to do stuff like that, it's like I blank out and don't think of content, but I'll think of content at like 1 a.m. on a Wednesday, which is not sustainable. Mm-hmm. But I just like get like a mental block. And then if once I try to do it, I get like hyper-focused on it. And I know that I've talked about this before, where I just, it's not efficient and I get too worried that it's not perfect. Mm-hmm. It could just be good and I could just move on and do stuff that are, you know, makes money or gives me time back or, sorry, that was kind of a word vomit, but.
No, it's great. So at the end of the goal, are you posting things so you can make more money?
Yeah, or keeping my name out and, you know,
awareness
and stuff like that. Yeah.
But the awareness will lead to new clients, which will lead to more money.
Oh yes. Sorry. Yes. Yes. That's the meaning of, yeah. Money is the goal.
Okay. So if you think of your content in that way, you can think of it in a more clear thing. So all my content is driving awareness to drive, marketing, to drive delivery, to drive a wonderful experience and maybe a return customer. And so you don't always have, if you feel like it's a vital part of your business, it's okay to let it go or to delegate it or to, you know, I would just reassess and think about that. And then one thing I'll be talking about is building triggers into your systems. So if you're really feeling like you can't motivate yourself, try and think of what are different triggers you can do or what simple systems that you can create and frameworks. Because I'll talk about essentialism a little bit and really getting into all the things that you're doing and reassessing, is this essential to my business? Because I'm the belief that if it doesn't impact your business at a 9 or a 10, why are you doing it? That's or real life. And actually, I don't want to just talk about business because I know we're all small business owners. So really everything we do also impacts our life because it's so tightly connected. And that may seem really extreme, but usually those things that are level 9 or that 9 or 10, and I want to say impact level, not necessarily feel good level, because I think right now we're definitely in a phase where we're being really self-awareness about our self-care, which is amazing. But I think sometimes we have, if we are like me posting on Instagram is a 9 impact to my business. Like if you're aware of that, you're like, okay, that matters. And like, that's where, like what Jasna said, like, okay, that's where discipline comes in. How can I train myself to understand the value of this activity? Cool. No, but that's great. And honestly, so many people struggle with that. So I struggle with that. I don't have to post right now because I'm not looking for new business. But when I was, like I said, I haven't posted since like November on my feed. And that's because it wasn't, I realized it didn't impact my business or my life. And I loved posting, but then I just realized it was taking up too much time and something I released. But I know other people that are that is their main place that they get their revenue and their clients is Instagram. And it's like the greatest. And that is like a core thing they want to focus on.
Kirsten, do you want to tell us really briefly how you reevaluated everything last November?
Yeah.
College?
Of course. Okay. So I went and I will share this slide, you guys. Give you a high level. And you might find errors on this. If you do, give me grace. I made it especially for you guys. So there we go. See, I used a template and I forgot to fill in my bio. There is one thing, but done is better than perfect, right? So here's some of the companies that I've worked with. And I was doing consulting and I was just working a lot. And then I was like, am I happy? Is this really what I want to do? Like, okay, I'm okay now, but do I want to be in the same place next year? And I said, no. And I realized that I needed to take a drastic shift in my actions because what I was doing now wasn't going to get me to where I wanted to be. And so I kind of, I stopped taking new clients. I still had my current clients and, to kind of like just keep me alive, but I was really just giving myself space to explore. And it was kind of scary because I wasn't really sure like, okay, how long is this self-exploration going to take? But I knew something was out of alignment. So I really do believe in like trusting your gut and you know what matters and you know, when you're getting signs to be like, hey, pay attention to this. So I made a wish list of almost like I was, you know, looking for a husband, but I did this for like my career. And I said, I want to work with other people who are Lean Six Sigma black belts. And by that it is, have you guys heard of what a Lean Six Sigma black belt is? It's basically like a process improvement specialist. And so I was kind of the only person advising. And I was like, you know, I really love collaboration and working together and sharing best practices. So I want to work with a team. I also want to have a long-term contract at least 6 months or a year because I felt like the work that I did really needed more time. And just to be like, just to do like, a one-day session or a 3 months engagement was too short, and really, I wasn't able to make the impact that I wanted. The next thing I realized is I needed to stop working with people under $500,000, and it wasn't because they couldn't afford me. It was because they didn't have enough revenue for me to use my skills to make a big enough difference to make it worth them hiring me. So like, for example, if it's a bigger company and I do an improvement, save time, save money, there's a much bigger ROI if you have more expenses. So if some of the business owners that I was working with, I might have been able to help them a lot, but it wasn't as valuable to them as it would have been to a larger company for the impact level. So I realized, okay, I need to work with a large company. So I kind of kept going down and like just everything, even to like the mindset of the people. And then 2 weeks later, I was texted by somebody that I'd met that summer. They reached out to me to be on their YouTube channel. And they're like, hey, so I don't know if you'd be interested in this, but I have this opportunity. It'd be for a year-long contract as a consultant. And you'd have to give up all your other clients. And I was like, I don't know. Like, I was kind of having a little bit of a commitment like issue, like, oh, I have to commit to them for a year. Like, I don't know. But I went through 5 interviews with Intuit. I even like read a textbook for one of my interviews that was a prerequisite. And then I ended up getting the offer. And I've been there, 3.5 months now? And it's been the most fulfilling work I've ever done in my life. And it all started with me being aware that this is not where I want to go, and then designing my own future and what that wanted to be. And I was also like updating my resume, applying for other opportunities in the meantime, because I also was open to like, if this is as a job and I'm able to, you know, check all these criteria, or if this is, I'm not sure like how the opportunities present myself, I'm gonna be open to different opportunities. And I did apply to like to a couple other things. I had interviews. So I think that also the thing to keep in mind is I was moving towards it, but I was in the place where I was ready, and I knew what was important to me, and I knew what I wanted for it to come. And it 10 times over is more than I could ever wanted in that career opportunity. So, and it came from a text message that came to me. So I also believe that if you put your intention out there and you are not, you know, and you stick to it and then take actions in that direction, you'll be surprised of what opportunities unveil to yourself.
Thank you for that great reminder for all of us in our business just to stay the course.
Of course. So I wanted to go ahead and talk about just the foundational mindset that I think will really help you, because yes, systems, processes, it will make your life so much easier, but really there's some thinking time and guidelines that come into that. And the 4 agreements has really been a life changer for me, in business and in life. By following these 4 things, be impeccable with your word, don't take anything personally, don't make assumptions, always do your best. Those help me sleep at night. And it's so simple, but if I can check those things off, amazing. And if I didn't do something, just remembering to give myself grace and know that I will do better tomorrow. Does anyone have any questions about the 4 agreements? Who's read it? Who's heard of it? Yeah, let me open the chat.
I was going to say it changed my husband's life. I read it a long time ago, and it's changed him so much that I'm going to have to reread it now, especially that you brought it up again. So.
Oh my gosh!
Yeah, he totally lives by that now. Big change.
Yeah, it's a mindset shift. And when you think of the world in this way, you're in control. And I think it's important too to reflect and understand when we're in victim mode, when we think that the world is against us, and really try and shift into that place of control and power. Not like trying to change things, but just understanding what you can change or what you can control, and everything else just release, because what are you going to do? Worry. Then that's about it that you can do. You read that book every year. Oh, the fifth agreement. Yes. That's a good one too. And it's really fast. It's a really fast book. I actually have like 10 of them and I give them out like all the time. It's like that one book that I do. And I'll keep going through the other ones later. But I really wanted to start with this, and you'll kind of find your systems through this. So for example, say that you get an email from a client that's like, where is this thing that you promised me? And you're like, oh, I can't believe they're, or like, then they're being nasty about it. And instead of taking it personally, you can reflect back and be like, did I set expectations correctly? Did I give them a guideline on when to receive it? Did I let them know, you know, maybe you got it through a text message. Did I, and you're like, how could they text me? This should be through email. Well, did you set clear guidelines on when you would be available to support them, how you would support them, things like that. So you'll find that in your triggers, you can develop systems to help set better expectations. All right, so Essentialism, as I was talking before, it is another incredible book that I highly recommend. It is talking about focusing, like it's like almost your North Star, Essentialism. And if you understand what you're working towards, the 9 or 10 opportunities are the yeses. Everything else is a no. And that may sound extreme, but it's the 7 and 8s that are the hardest for us, because you're like, oh, well, that looks fun, or that seems nice, or I could do that, or, but is it really going to move you forward to where you want to be? And when you have this clear North Star, then it's so much easier for you to say no. And no is such a powerful thing, and you can use it, and there's some examples in the book too on how to say no. And like when I like, there's one that's like, oh, I'm so honored that you would even ask me, but you know, I'm actually very busy right now or something. I forget the actual term, but it's like, you don't have to be like, oh, I'm going to say no, now it's going to be horrible. It's like, you can make it a light no, or just being honest and saying that is totally fine too. So, with Essentialism, I really feel like it gives you the space. And so one of the misconceptions about organization is I need labels, I need, you know, or I need like more folders to organize. But if you have less stuff or less things to manage, you have less to organize. So it's a lot simpler. So just try and clear out the things that don't matter. And it's going to take time. Give yourself like 6 months to really do this, because you're going to go through different parts of your life, and then you'll test and adjust, and you'll think, oh, I think I need this, or, and then you'll realize, oh, actually I do value this. So it's not like a one and done. I'm going to like Marie Kondo my business and life in like a weekend. You may start there, but it's always going to be a consistent process, and you're always going to have to go back to what matters most. And that may shift, you know, maybe like a parent gets sick, and then that is what matters most. And so that is your North Star. And then everything else is set. Does anyone have any questions around that? Let's see. Yeah, and I think like always optimizing. And I think that is one of the mindsets that you have to have, is just like, you're always improving, and it's a fun journey of improvement. It's, you know, we're never gonna kind of, you're gonna get there, but I like to think of it more as a feeling get there, and also a quantify the get there as well. Yes, that one, Essentialism by Greg McKeown. Amazing book, amazing book. All right, so let's talk about the 6 systems that you need in your business. First off, who feels like they have these different systems? And by support systems, I mean, I'll just ask, who thinks that they have these? Who needs to build them? Who's like, what is one of those? most of them. Awesome. Cool. Okay. So let's talk about marketing systems. Those are the systems that create, generate a continuous flow of leads into your business and also can help you communicate a clear brand identity to your audience. So as we were talking earlier about the social media, if you feel like it is vital for you to do these two things, yeah, like this is something you need to have a system around. Seeing some chats pop up. Perfect. Okay, so I want you guys to take action. Make a list of your reoccurring marketing tasks that you have to do, or if you already have a system around that. And I have a time cube.
Kirsten, do you want to just give us like what would be a list that would fall into the marketing systems? Like what are some of the things, just to give ideas if people don't know what you mean by that?
Yeah, so anything that you do, any tasks that you do, so maybe if you haven't created your marketing systems, that's okay, but what are the tasks or the things that you do in order to market yourself or your business? And some might already be systemized and some might just be like on a list that you keep every day. So like, for example, posting on LinkedIn or posting on social media, reaching out for PR opportunities to keep it high level. That's kind of high. So like then also like, are you looking at your numbers to see which things people are clicking on, which things people are not clicking on?
Is creating content on this list?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and you can get that if you can get that micro too. So like maybe think of the end goal that you do and then you can go back from there. So you create content for these different platforms or these different blog posts. And I'll give you guys one more minute. And this is just gonna be like a high level, kind of just get these things out of your head. And mostly, and think of like the pain points, which are the ones that, yeah, like you hate to do, or you feel are really important, or you feel like you don't have a consistent way. Like if you were going to hire somebody today, do you have like a clear outline of what their role and responsibilities were if they were to take over these marketing responsibilities, marketing tasks?
Kirsten, do you happen to have a checklist of sorts for something like this? Because we have a lot of people like, I don't even know where to start.
Yeah, you know, I think it depends on the size, the type of business you are. I think that checklists are great, but it also in the name of essentialism is I don't want to give people more tasks than they need.
Got it.
So, cause sometimes we can get the like list of 182 things and then we think we need to do that. But really just, you know, strike and not do that. So maybe like we need to create, you want to post on like, so find the top places that you want to focus on for social media or for marketing, and then define what you need to do to put that out there. And then how are you going to track that content is actually leading to your goal? And Bonnie, we'll go ahead and start with you. If you want to like live workshop right now, is that all right? Okay.
Yeah.
You can share your, here you can, let's see, where are you? I'll stop sharing real quick. Okay, Bonnie, tell me about your business.
I am just starting with, a life coach, business executive coach. Mm-hmm. I love the idea of working with energy, seeing how people show up for their, when they're in business, how are they showing up to reach their goals? Mm-hmm. I'd like to get into doing personal coaching, but also I'd love to get into corporations where I'm in there and seeing what is working for people, for companies. And I'm really interested in what you do, because when you had brought up the idea of a process improvement, that light goes like, whoosh, it's exactly it. But I'm just starting. Yeah. I have no idea what I know or what I don't know. So I'm just starting.
That's all good. So do you have a clear offer yet that you have, or are you still working on developing that?
I'm still working on developing it. I am starting to do a lot more practice coaching stuff right now to kind of see what, you know, kind of work my comfort zone a little bit. And I just got my certification for doing the Energy Leadership Index. So that just came in. But yeah, right now I'm working on it.
Awesome. Do you know who your ideal client is?
I'm working on that right now too.
Awesome. Just high level.
Kind of creating an avatar. An avatar. Right now, it would be just someone who just feels like they know that inside them that there's something more. Like they're good, they're happy, but they're just fine. So I'd like to work with people who want to take themselves from fine to extraordinary. From I know I can do it. I know it's inside me. I just need to undo these blocks. And that's the person I want to work with one-on-ones. In a corporation, I'd like to go in and help people figure out, you know, where the company's blocks are, the individual employees that need to work for teams. How is it that they can work together better?
If you were to say that you were to start with one, like, North Star that you're going to put all of your energy towards, because we know that if you have energy, it's the same amount. If you split it between multiple things, it can only go this far. But if you have one focus or two focuses, it goes this far. So which of these are you most excited about? Or do you think, which of these do you think can pay you? Which of these has the most opportunity for you to make money?
Right now it's the one-on-one coaching. I'd like to work with professional women or professional men who want to get better with their business. And I believe that when I'm working with these people, that it will trickle into their personal lives as well.
Now, are these professionals in corporate? Are they leaders of small businesses? Like what do they look like?
I think they look like they can be anything. I mean, right now, if I close my eyes and imagine, it's anyone from that's already a leader in their company or someone who wants to start their own company or people with really big, kind of like they want to take that next step, you know, in transition, I guess, the big transition.
Transition. Okay. So a transition in leadership. Transition in leadership. Okay. I do want to say I love where you're going. And the one thing that I noticed is whenever you're working with new business owners is that they do want leadership support, but they also want you to support them in how do I do my accounting? How do I do my contracts? How do I do all these other things? So if you do go towards that route, just make sure you have really clear boundaries on where your support is, that you're not an all-in-one business coach. Or if you want to focus on the person that's in corporate, then that they probably don't have a lot of those things that they have to worry about. And then another thing I want to talk about too is think about where they are in their business. If they're brand new, they probably have not a consistent stream of income, right? And so sometimes that can put them into lack or can put them into other things that might block your coaching. And I don't want you guys to think like, oh, don't help people that are just starting. But as you're just starting, think where is people that have a consistent way to pay me? Because at the end of the day, we're in a you have to run your business like a business. You have to understand, you know, where, you know, who is the market or who's going to pay me? And, you know, what does that look like? And then as you build that stable foundation, then you know, you can go and experiment with more other things. But just, and I don't know if anyone else has that same experience, but to go back to your marketing systems is really taking the thinking time, the foundational time to understand, okay, who is this person I'm talking to? And that's why it's so important to know that, because if you focus on, because they're hanging out in different places. So you want to try and build systems that are going to drive to those places and not drive, build systems and processes and things that will go to everywhere. So maybe start with local you know, women in leadership groups or LinkedIn.
Mm-hmm. I just wrote that down.
Perfect. Perfect. And so start, so where are you currently doing marketing right now?
I'm not right now. Okay. Mostly like maybe some social media a little bit, but what that's about it. Pardon me?
What kind of social media are you doing?
Mostly just about me and my interests, you know, not a lot mm-hmm. about my business.
Okay. Yet. Is it on Instagram?
It's on Instagram. I just talked to Angela, actually, she's here in the group, about how to really focus my Instagram posting. And so I'm working on that right now and working on branding myself right now. So I will be changing how I do it, because now I kind of, to be honest with you, I just really don't like social media. I see it as being more harmful than good personally. So I stayed away from it, but I know I need to shift my mind. And mm-hmm. so working with Angela a little bit, getting more focused on what my Instagram is, like who I'm trying to talk to.
Yeah.
And so that yeah. I'm working on.
Yeah. That's really great that you're getting support in that area. But if you do feel that it's more harmful than good, maybe start in person, you know, start your marketing efforts in person. Like, what is the path of least resistance, and to just get going? But that is great that you have someone to support you. And I would recommend that for systems. If you are really don't, you really don't feel that it's working or not that it's working, you don't like it, delegate it. If you feel like it's something that's very vital. So that's awesome.
Those are some of my goals, is eventually I want to get to the mm-hmm. point where I have someone that's doing my social media, someone that's, whether it's a virtual assistant or mm-hmm. someone else, but someone that I could, eventually, once I get to know me and what I want to say, mm-hmm. to communicate that to someone else. That's mm-hmm. absolutely something I'd like to do.
Yeah, so definitely focus your efforts for, you know, maybe 3 months or 6 months on that. But be looking every month, like, okay, which posts are leading new clients to me, or how, or because mm-hmm. you need to measure it, or else it's just a nice to have. And so really at the end of the day, to run a business, you need to make money. And I hope people aren't like hating me saying that, because I had a lot of money blocks, like when I first started, and I was like, oh, but I just want to help. But if you don't help yourself first, if you're not strong and feel mm-hmm. good and have that, then, oh my gosh, it's really hard to move forward. So, yeah. Sure. See, Nicole, I used to dislike social media, and then I changed my mindset to focus on being the good and shutting out the negativity. Molly folks, yeah. No, that's so good. Feel free to mute people if you don't want to like that. So when you're building your marketing systems, I would just, now you have guidance. So that's where you start. You focus on the work that you're doing with, was it Angela?
Yes, Angela.
Angela, yes. So, that's it. It's that simple. Just focus there and then don't worry about the, like, build as you go, you know, we don't need to do all the things. Awesome. How do you feel?
I feel awesome. I feel great. I feel like mentioned earlier, talking to Angela, who I just noticed isn't here today. Cause I want to say kudos. She did a great job. If anyone mm-hmm. wants to talk to her, she's amazing. But I feel really good. I feel like I'm learning more about where to really focus on what I want to do, and mm-hmm. instead of trying to please everybody, really please and work with the people I really want to be able to pay me and pay me well and get the most out of what I'm trying to give them. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I love everything you've said.
Great. I love that. So when I say where to start, I mean, like, what is your marketing funnel? What is that one to three areas? And do tests, do sprints. Don't think of it, this is my forever marketing, it needs to be perfect. Get it out there, be messy, be agile. When someone makes a mistake, it usually brings a comment, or, you know, I'm not saying make mistakes, but like,
no, I know.
Do things that are going to be conversation starters that'll help you get feedback, ask for feedback. You know, do, and as you're building your one of your marketing could be voice of the customer. And so people that you think might be ideal customers is do some research, since you're at that phase of understanding who is my person.
So when you said voice to customers, what does that mean?
Oh, sorry, voice the customer. So that is like a process of just doing research and surveys and getting feedback. So whether that's a quick survey, whether that's so people that you think that you want to work with, this will help you narrow it down. You can do like a quick phone call. So the system or the process that you would have behind that is, okay, who am I reaching out to? What am I sending them? Am I sending them a text? Is that a template that I can just shift a little bit? How am I going to schedule the time with them if it's a call? And then the call, what are you going to say on the call? And then post-call. So that would be like your process on that.
Okay.
Yeah, and then that could help you inform your marketing.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. And then some of those could lead to sale, could lead directly into sales, which would be the next system that you would want to think about.
Okay.
Does anyone have any other questions or clarifying on how to kind of like just really simplify and get down to like the next step, like what matters most? All right. So I'm going to go back to my screen. Good job. And I'm super excited about your business. The world needs more support with energy and leadership. And so I think what you're doing is amazingly valuable.
Well, thank you.
All right. So okay. So now we're going to go to sales system. So you can impress them with your marketing campaign, but if your sales process is sketchy, you will lose your client's trust. Who feels like they have a dynamite sales process? And it's okay to brag. I like when people think, like, feel excited about their sales process.
This is Maria. What would you define as like dynamite? Because I feel like when I get sales, it's just sort of by happenstance and not by anything that I've created. So would dynamite be something that like that you've, like your systems are in place and then it's, and then you've created a sale? If that's the case, mine is a no.
I would say like a dynamite sales process would be maybe something that is like you feel good that what the moment that someone's interested, they know how to, it's like a consistent process to get to you. It doesn't have to be too laid out. So with yours, I would say you are obviously doing something right in the marketing. And then how can we tighten up the sales system as well?
Okay.
So what are the things that you think are kind of inconsistent in your sales approach? So it's like the moment someone's like interested to the moment they buy is really the sales like chunk.
Well, I'm a terrible salesperson. I'll take my screen off too. I feel like I'm a terrible salesperson because I'll just be like, well, if you don't want to buy it, you don't have to. Like, it's okay, no pressure. Like, I'm bad trying to like get people's money. So I do the opposite. Like, I really try to like dissuade them. So then in my head, it's like, well, then they really want to buy it. if I've told them that they don't have to. It's terrible. I'm a terrible salesperson.
Do you think what you have to offer is valuable?
Yes. I have to think about that. Yes, 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 I do.
Do you think it's going to change their life? Or do you think it's going to make it better? It doesn't even have to change your life. It's going to make it better.
Yeah. I think it'll make it better. I think, yes. I sell like shirts. So I feel weird saying it'll make it better. But I think the message behind my business will make it better. Not actually the physical product. Does that make sense? I don't know if that makes sense.
Yeah. Let's see what some people are chatting. Yeah, I think that maybe if you tighten up your delivery process, it'll give you confidence in your sales because they feed each other.
Mm-hmm.
And then your sales process is something I've always focused on, something that can be adapted but is definitely able to be repeated. Shirts are empowering. I want to see your shirts. I'm excited about that. So I think there's an underlying something there that you have definite awareness of, is that you're trying to talk your customers out of your sales. So how can you make a process that helps you feel confident as well? Like, what do you need to talk about testimonials? You need to like what is it that you can, and maybe that's just also just some working through that.
I think the where I feel most comfortable is when I'm focusing on other people.
Mm-hmm.
When it's the lens or the story or the camera is turned on me, that I like break out into nervous like sweats. But if I can focus on other people, then I can promote their stuff and sell their stuff. I'm a great salesperson for other people.
Okay. Yeah. So what are some examples of when you don't feel confident selling your stuff?
I think so, like in the niche that I am in, it's really sort of competitive and almost like mean girl in a way. And so like getting into that sort of like the click of it all, I just hate it. So I tend to stay on the outside and not put myself out there.
Mm-hmm.
I know it's ironic because my whole brand is about being authentic and vulnerable. And, you know, I understand that's a little ironic, but yeah.
We all feel that. I mean, we all feel that. It's, you know, a competition and things like that. One, I was watching this YouTube about the CEO of Alibaba, super, super incredible guy. And he says that he feels love for his competitors and he encourages them. So I think it's like, don't necessarily think of them as a competition. And they're choosing their, and then so all you have to do is just show what's special, not necessarily what's different from everyone else, but just what's special from you and how can you pull that out. And like you said, I think it's really important in the sales process to make your clients the star, make the customer the star, and you are in service to the customer. So how can your sales and delivery system support that?
I know that people have talked about this, kind of Ashley touched on this our last call. But like, how do I get comfortable on like, or how do we, or anybody, I guess, on like price point? Because sometimes also a big barrier that I feel like I worry if my stuff is too expensive or if what I'm providing isn't worth, you know, it's so in my head, I'll be like, well, that's dumb. No one's going to want to pay X amount for a t-shirt when they could go to, which I feel like you'd probably just answer my question. Okay. You just said that. You got to be different.
So I'm going to recommend that you watch the Sarah Blakely masterclass.
Okay.
She talks about product pricing. That's not my expertise. I make sure that I stay in my lane when I'm supporting people because I'm not the best at pricing. I can build you a process to define that. But she talks about when you're doing consumer goods, because you know she has Spanx, about the margins that you should be doing. And she talked about when she was a salesperson for a company. I think she sold like fax machines or printers or something. And she always went in and she she was like trying to tell everyone how amazing it was. And she was like, and it's cheaper than the best one. And people were like, there must be something wrong. I think she doubled the price, or she increased the price more than the competition. And that was almost the talking point. It was like, oh wow, you're more expensive. Tell me why. And so then it gave her the opportunity to do that, and people valued it more. So pricing is also a mental game. It's not, you know, it's people will buy the same watch if it has a different brand name, but it could be, or same sunglasses are a great example. They might be made by the same manufacturer that costs like $5 to make, but one is a Gucci brand name on it, and it's, you know, $300, $500. Another one is $12 at the local gas station, and they might be made at the same manufacturer. So it's the value that you bring to the perceived value of the brand. And so when you're doing your marketing, that is the leading to the sales and the sales.
I was just going to ask. So then the marketing would be how you're bringing the value to it. And
But pricing is something that everyone struggles with. I was told double what you're comfortable with. Because then you always have room for negotiation too, if you do your business that way. Another great masterclass that I recommend is on negotiation, and he wrote the book Never Split the Difference. It's incredible, and I highly, highly, highly recommend it. Has anyone watched it?
What is the webinar called, or the training?
It's like a negotiation masterclass, but the guy also wrote Never Split the Difference. His name, oh, I have it right here. Chris Voss. He was an FBI negotiator. Check out his, even YouTube, go on YouTube. There is a masterclass. I think it's buy one, get one free. So if anyone wants to, go in together, some are amazing, some are meh. But as you're seeing, it's a lot of thinking work that has to go in to your systems. So it's okay to have a light framework and then test and adjust, but it's really what makes the system or the process powerful is being decisive and trying something and learning. Masterclass. Oh, his name is Chris Voss. Also, Bob Iger has one, and he talked about how he negotiated some of the acquisitions. Very, very interesting, some of the tactics that he used. V-O-S-S, Voss. So I think that kind of leads into some of the problems that people have with systems. They might set everything, try and make it perfect, build it perfectly. Build as you go. And you're going to always be reiterating what you're working on. All right. So anyone have any questions about sales systems? And this is why I don't necessarily give a checklist, because I want it to be as agile as you need and as simple as you need. Like, start with just the things that matter most and move from there. So just think of, how do people buy from you? Like, where is the place that people make the purchase? Is it a phone call? Is it your website? So what is the system around that? Like, what do they see on your website? What buttons do they push? Once they push it, what is that trigger? What is that process between when they're interested to when they decide to purchase? So I'm going to give you guys a couple minutes to go ahead and write down some of the tasks that you would do in your marketing system. Or sorry, sales system. And some of them are lead management, maybe discovery calls, payment processing and refunds. Those might be some buckets to give you guys an example. Give you guys 30 more seconds. I love that, Bonnie. Your payment process creates an easy way to pay me. Mm-hmm. And be fearless with your worth. Uh-huh. Yep. All right. Does anyone want to share some of the sales systems that they're going to start working on?
I'll share mine.
Yeah.
I'm a wedding photographer and I do family stuff too, but this is the process that I already have in place. That I put in place over the winter, and it's really been working well for me. So I use Dubsado.
Cool. Yeah.
So when somebody contacts me on my website, I get an email about it and it creates a project. Mm-hmm. And then I just respond with like a general response with pricing information, but then I have a link where they can just click it and schedule a 15-minute phone call with me. Mm-hmm. Because all my pricing is on my website, so I feel like once they know that, they kind of know if they want to keep going. Mm-hmm. And anything going back and forth through email just wasn't productive at all. So right when we get on the phone call, then I can kind of like get to know them better, figure out if we're a match. And since I've been doing that and getting on the phone with them, it has increased my chances of booking like drastically. I think I've only not booked twice.
Amazing. That's awesome.
Mm-hmm. And then I usually follow up with like an email right away, just kind of going over everything we talked about, more so I don't forget. and then if they want to go ahead, then I send over the contract invoice and then we're booked. And then I have a questionnaire. But
all right. Can we all just give her an applause for her amazing system? I think you are rock star status. Yes. That's the dynamite sales system right there. Cool. And you know what? There are easy systems that can build that for you. And Dubsado is one of those for small businesses. You can do your payment processing through it. You can do your scheduling. It's pretty robust and I highly recommend people look into it. And Charlotte, you probably have a referral code that you can send to everybody if they want to try it out, I'm sure, right? You have like something in the back end, an affiliate.
Yes, and I just realized my daughter's name is on here, so I'm changing. I'm Audrey, sorry.
Oh, hey, Audrey.
Charlotte. Sorry.
Yeah, and I think that what?
I do have a referral code, so if anybody wants it. But
yeah, that'd be great.
So Dubsado is great. Another one is HoneyBook, but that's more for creatives. And so those are different ones that are client management systems that have integrations and you can go ahead and sometimes they have even templates of building things. So think of also like, I'll talk about course builders in the next system, but this is kind of like, it'll help you track who's interested. And like she said, you can connect it to your website or to your Instagram or to whatever, and then it can set them through this flow, a systemized flow. But to begin with, you have to think about, okay, well, when they get into my flow, what am I going to say to them? And it's okay if you don't need to write them a novel, just like put something in there. And so the first client is going to be, you know, that goes through it, it's going to be like, you know, it doesn't have to be perfect. So you can just go in and edit at any time. How long do you think that would take you to set up, Audrey? Maybe you could do it within less than a day, right?
To set up the Dubsado office?
Uh-huh.
It takes a little while. I wouldn't say a day just because you have to, like, I wanted to just dive in and do all the fun things.
Mm-hmm.
You have to like build to get to that.
Yep.
Otherwise, none of it works.
Mm-hmm.
So I watched every YouTube tutorial there was so mm-hmm. that I could understand it because I wanted it to do a lot for me.
Mm-hmm.
So now I get it, but it took me a minute. Mm-hmm. And I could definitely help anybody because at first it's like, what? But once you like realize what it can do for you, you're just like, I need this.
Yeah. Yeah. And start simple. Like, yes, you can update your brand colors and your logo and your other things like that. But it, like, just get the system working first, like make that your priority and then enhance it with the pretty stuff. Like get it functional, get it working, have a friend test it out, you know? But there are different ways that you can do this. And some of them even have templates in there that you can just customize a little bit. So that might help. And yes, I think your payment processing and refunds is really important. And think about also what goes in your sales is a contract. So these are like key items, and it doesn't even need to be like a formalized contract, but what is the agreement that you're having? You know, if there were, and a lot of people call them agreements, but really they're disagreements. So what happens when things don't go the way that you think they're going to be? Yeah, so that those will help you and it'll be more clear. And then when you're thinking about your payment processing too, or the payments, it is simpler if you have a very clear understanding of what you want to charge and how low you'll go. I have a friend who's a photographer, which you, Audrey, you might want to join her group. Her name is Meg Marie Photography, and she's actually training other brand photographers on how to, or photographers on how to build their business. But she went down and she created a spreadsheet of how much time it takes her to do every single thing when it comes to a client. Like the discovery call, the emails, the, and then all the different things in her process. And then she decided, and then how much she charged, and she was able to see how much she was charging herself per hour based on that work. So if you want to really see, like, cause a lot of times when we make prices, we think that we're probably working more than we think we are. So if you want to really break that down, that can help you understand like, oh wait, no, I don't want to go below this much an hour. So you know that you'll never go below this much money when you're talking to a client. And that really helps you give yourself hard lines. And then you'll notice that when you go below that, you'll, what I've heard and what I've felt is that you feel like you're being taken advantage of, or you feel like you're worth more. So it's just better to hold the line, but you have to decide where the line is for yourself. All right. Dipsato is amazing. Yes, that's great. Yes. And use each other's referral code. Yeah. And you don't always have to build things from scratch. Use templates. I'm sure you guys all use Canva. Like, make it easy. You don't need to build everything from scratch. There's no badge of armor in that. So find people that are already doing what you're doing and look at their systems. Look at how, like, sign up for their thing. Look at the things that you're being sent. You know, modify the stuff that they're doing. You know, I don't encourage copying at all, or, you know, things like that, but they didn't invent the wheel. So use that as a guide point and as a reference for people that you admire in your business. Look at their systems and how they're moving you through a flow. I sometimes sign up for people's stuff just because I want to see how they do that. Yes, stalk them. Katie's a good person to stalk. She does good stuff. But it takes time. It takes time to build those things. All right, guys. So we already did that. Okay, delivery systems. Now, this is the most important thing because a lot of people might get on the phone or promise things, and then you got to deliver on the promise. So that's where your delivery systems come into place. So from the moment that you say, that they say, yep, I'm on board, which Dipsato can take that as well. They have like a client portal and things like that. To when you deliver. And I actually want to say the end of your delivery system is when you get their feedback. So think of the moment that they pay you to the moment that you get feedback from them is your delivery system. Katie says she's templates for everything, newsletter, social media posts, and book brush to save templates. Nice. I also love the Chrome extension, Toby. It's a way to organize your like bookmark tabs in categories. And for me, it's been a nice way for systems like when I am going need to say I'm going to be doing status reports for projects, I'll just have like a status reports section, and then it'll open up all the different tabs of projects that I'm working on, so I can go through and just batch it. So you'll want to try, and when you're doing the different things, to batch the work together, and that'll help you move through things faster and not context switch as much.
Can you share what it looks like to do to have the Toby up? Like it, so it has all your tabs open that you're going to use for that task?
Is let me show you.
Okay, I'd love to see that.
Yeah. So here's my Toby. And so like daily money, it goes my YNAB, my personal budget, my business budget, my business bank account, and my credit card. And that's so every cool. morning, I just literally click open four tabs, and I'm able to, I'll talk about this later when I talk about money systems, but I realized that I need to have daily visibility to my money because I had an avoidance tendency, and I got out of $50,000 in debt in 4 months because I got real intentional and I made a plan. And we think of budget sometimes as what am I going to do with the money that I have, or you know, this very static kind of thing. And really, you need a budget. YNAB has helped me be, thank you. it helped me be proactive, so able to forecast my money. And it's an incredible, incredible tool that I highly, highly recommend. But I'll give more context on that. YNAB, Y-N-A-B. And I'll send everybody my link for that. I love it so much. I think you can get like a free... like month or free 33 days or something like that. I'm not sure, but I think it gives me a free month back, but I pay for a year. I'm not sure how it works, but I'll send you guys my link. It's amazing. And so think about, as you're going through these things, think about like, wouldn't it be nice if there was a thing that did this, and then Google it. Someone probably made some sort of thing that's niche that way, and try and stay away from like all-in-one solutions that are going to like do every single thing, because they might not really do everything great. So just focus on what you really need and then just go from there. All right. Okay. So some efficiency hacks that I was talking about is like templates. So anything that you do more than once, create a template for it. And Katie had a great resource that she says, BookBrush, which I'll actually have to look into that too. I've never looked at that. Also automation. So is there a way that you can automate this? For example, emails, if you don't have like a client management system like Audrey, you can use scheduling tools in Gmail to schedule out an email. So there's ways that you can automate, or there's also, if you're more techie, or if you get things set up, there's things called like Zapier, or if this, then that. And that you can actually, this is what I think is like gold star systems, like, or diamond. Because then you like, you know what the content of the system is, then you make it work for you. And then the automation is when you like connect it and make it smart to link together. And it kind of, one thing triggers the next thing, and they can go through different systems and tools and things like that. So, that's, give yourself lots of grace for that. Or you can do automations where it matters most, you know. And then guidelines or SLAs. And what I mean by SLA is service level agreements. So again, taking the power, how do I want to run my business? What are the agreements that I'm going to have around my service? As a photographer, you might say, my service level agreement is you will get your photos within 2 weeks or 1 month or whatever that is. So you already go through and you understand, if you contact me, I'll get back to you same day. Or if it's on a weekend, I'll get back to you, you know, within the next business day kind of thing. So what are those things that you want to define around the way you operate and in your business. And that's going to be really helpful, because once you define that, then you're going to be like, how am I communicating this? And if there's still confusion, how can you reiterate this in your process, or how can you reinforce it? Because probably the most important thing that you can do is, whatever you do, just communicate. So how can you have the act of communication? And you can build systems and templates around that. All righty. All right, so some support systems that you might, Okay, so take some time and write down maybe some delivery systems that you might need. And so some one example is onboarding. How are you onboarding a client? Do you have a consistent way to be like, welcome, or confirm their order, or things like that? Also, if a customer has questions, do you have like an FAQ that you want to develop, or do you need an autoresponder? Do you give this one video about how energy work will help you be a better leader? Do you want to make that one video that you send out in the onboarding sequence? All right, anyone have questions around delivery systems? All right, so we're gonna talk about support systems. Support systems are the things that are the underlying systems to everything else. So a lot of times this is like admin things. So for example, how are you going to manage your passwords? How are you managing your projects? What is your document filing system? Because everyone needs to put their stuff somewhere. And one of the guidelines that you would create, for example, for the document filing is naming conventions. So for example, you could have a folder that's to be filed.
It's on the step. Oh, sorry.
What's that?
Oh, no, I didn't know I was on mute. Sorry.
Oh, no worries. How do you want to, what are the chunks? How do you want to name those? And then you have your document filing system. So like whenever a client gives me something, I know that I want to put it into here. I'm going to have a client folder. Once they're done, it's going to go into archives. So go ahead and also password management. I use LastPass, and it's awesome. And it's a great way if you ever need your clients' passwords. And I'm going to give you another hack. You might not have to make this system. You might be able to go to YouTube and find a how-to video and just pull that link into there. So remember, to be agile, you don't need to reinvent the wheel. There is so much information on the internet. And it's good to keep this documentation as you go. So then the moment you do need to hire, it's ready. And you know how you do things. And it can be more like light framework, or what you want to do is also when you're doing stuff, screen record yourself. There is a great system also called Loom, loom.com. And it is able, it's a great way for you to make tutorials or screen shares or just videos. And I highly recommend as you're doing things that you want to make a system, that's a way that you can create like a standard operating procedure and then just file that away. right. So we are running low on time, so I'm going to just keep going. So I think one of the most important things is money systems. You should know how much money you're making and how much money you're spending. Who here has struggled with money systems? I mean, I was not in debt at all, and then I opened a business, and then I was $50,000 in debt. Half of that was because of past IRS payments that I didn't file because I didn't feel comfortable filing my taxes. And I hired people to help me and for accounting. And the first person, they didn't necessarily, again, I don't want to play victim, but I didn't feel like I was getting the support I needed. But I was giving all of the power and being like, I don't understand it, you just do it. So I was really avoiding. I was just like, just trying to push the obligation. But as a business owner, you have to know the laws that apply to you, because at the end of the day, when you file your taxes, it is you that is certifying that you agree that this is correct, right? So I was just so nervous, like, because I started my business, I probably didn't have separate accounts for my money. Everything was going through one. So I really, if you, the one thing to start with is just look at your money system. Do I know how much money is going in and out? Do I know how much money I want to spend on my business? Am I treating it like a separate business where this is going there and that's going there? I'm still a sole proprietor, so technically my money flows through, but I pay myself a certain amount. I highly recommend the book Profit First. It's amazing. It gives a very simple way for you to manage your money. Just like how much you should pay yourself, think about, you know, taxes and all those things too. And then also, like I mentioned before, YNAB, you need a budget. That is amazing. But even at minimum, if you want to use something like Mint, which is an Intuit product, which is where I consult for, they're great too. But that's more of like awareness. I think of Mint as more awareness of the past, what's happened. And so then you can know what's happened, and then you need a budget, which you're going to fall in love with it. I will tell you, there's a learning curve on that. But once you get over it, it is so great. And there's a guy that I love watching. Oh my gosh, what is his name? He does tutorials for you need a budget. I'll send it to you guys. He's amazing. I think it's Nick True or something. But I learned how to use the software by doing that. And you can customize it any way you want, but it really helps you plan. And so sometimes when you're like, oh wow, I really want this, then it tells you like, well, can I afford it? And I think I'm all about making investments in yourself. Absolutely. But you want to make sure that you're making, intentional decisions based on your current understanding. There's a company that is great, very simple, Bench. They do accounting, and you have your like own accounting team. QuickBooks does it too, which I'm actually just starting with them now because I'm actually testing how they work because I'm working on their product. But I know that I think Bench is a little bit cheaper, and then you have a customized accountant, and so they kind of help you with itemizing expenses or deciding different things. So there are resources that you can use to get started on that.
I have a quick question for you.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You said Mint is kind of like just awareness, and I've used Mint before, and when I do use it, I stay way more on track just seeing what I'm spending. But what do you recommend then other than Mint for not just awareness, but yeah.
We need a budget. YMD.
Mm-hmm. YMD. Yes, I've heard of that. Okay.
They're awesome.
You need a budget. Okay. Uh-huh.
And what I did is I set up my categories in two. I have a business budget and I have a personal budget, and I'm able to see all the fixed things. So I don't necessarily like do it by fun and self-care and rent, I do it by like, what are the things that I know I'm spending money on? Like whether it's a need or a want, like I've decided I want to spend money on this. So I have that fixed amount that I'm paying, pardon me, every month for that. And then I understand like how much I want to pay myself, how much I want to save in my 401k. Guys, even if it's like a little bit, think about starting a 401k. I did a lot of research and I decided to do an individual 401k. And because if you have no employees, you can put a lot more in than a regular, than an IRA or a traditional 401k. So that's why I chose that one. But just like think about these things and start small. So if you have debt, Dave Ramsey's baby steps, they're just like tried and true. I went with that kind of methodology and that's great. And it kind of gives you like emergency fund, pay off, his system's great. Emergency fund, pay down your debt, bigger emergency fund, invest in yourself and give to others. So he does encourage giving, but he's like, get yourself out of the well first. Like stop putting this money or buying this person a lot like things if you can't even get yourself out. So I highly recommend that. And then I just want to talk about high level. It's really important to document what's happening today. And then documenting where you want to be. Second. So then you can look and see what are the gaps. And we call that a gap analysis. So what do I need to do today in order to get to where I want to be tomorrow? And one way when you're looking at the gaps or the problems, you can do a root cause analysis. And one simple, simple way to do that is called five whys. So the problem is, why am I not selling more? Why are we not selling more? And then you ask five levels deep, why? You know, why was I late to the meeting today? Well, there was traffic. Why was there traffic? Well, because it was rush hour and I left, you know, late. Okay, why did I leave late? Well, I didn't set my alarm. Okay, why didn't I set my alarm? Because I manually do it every day. Okay, so the thing that I'm gonna implement now is have my alarm automatic, like set for the Monday through Friday kind of thing. So you can kind of do the five levels of root cause analysis to understand that. So I know that I went pretty long. So I'll go just to the, if anyone has any last questions or that's kind of like the high level on how to think about your systems. Always think of it towards the end goal. The end goal is for you to make money so you can stay in business, right? Like otherwise, let's just all work for charities and do that work. But I don't want to undervalue, obviously, all the wonderful things like throughout that. But really, if you can kind of think, how is my business profitable? Is like, you know, and how am I building my systems to support that so I can support others? I think that's it's a good way to start pre-framing. And then all these other things don't matter, you know, all these other kind of like nice to haves, unless it makes you feel good, unless you feel like it's worth it. You know, I think that's important. Anyone have any questions? Oh, I do want to mention, I did create a system called Inbox Zen. And it is how to manage your email. So if you're feeling overwhelmed with email, I'll send you guys out a link for that. It's a course. And, you know, it's just a simple process that I've created to help manage all the email. But yeah, really it comes down to understanding what matters most to you and moving towards that.
Thank you for all your help.
All right. If you guys want to put in the comments, what was the biggest thing that stood out to you during our time today? Oh, there's 33 new messages I didn't see.
I enjoyed the marketing funnel and kind of the ideas you had on the voice of the customer survey, or kind of in thinking of that as a mindset when I'm maybe speaking with potential customers, is to go in with questions that help me kind of evolve my business a little bit more.
Awesome. Anyone else? Let's see.
I really like how you break everything down so that it's easier to conquer, because when you think about like something big, you just kind of get overwhelmed with it, but then you've taken it down to like smaller mm-hmm. steps, and that yeah. really helps. Like even that last thing, the whys, like that, thinking about a problem in that way, just mm-hmm. I can totally see how that can help find a solution.
Awesome. And really, if you want to start somewhere, start with the systems and the delivery, or the sales and delivery processes. And then maybe bounce back to marketing. Because, you know, you might build the dream, but then if you can't deliver on the dream, you know, then that's going to maybe hurt your reputation. So just high level, get a little bit of a light system around that, just how you want what you want that customer journey to be like. And then maybe put more effort into the marketing. Awesome. Marketing books to read. I mean, I like The Lean Startup. I think that's a really great business book in general. And then also for like a simplification book, The One Thing is a great book.
What was the business book? You said Lean?
The Lean Startup.
The Lean Startup.
Yeah. And also just one of the greatest things I found from my masterminds that I've been in is a lot of the resources are like within your group or one, you know, referral away. So if you're having struggles with certain things, you know, reach out to your community and you know, you can support each other for sure. All right. Well, I will stop sharing my screen now. Where is my Zoom? Yeah, it looks like you've got some ninjas in the group to help you with like personal finance and marketing and things like that. That's awesome.
We do have ninjas. We have some really, really powerful women. You know, and that's just the beauty. We talked about it even in our mastermind. The beauty of being in a room together is that how much we could help each other, which mm-hmm. is really brilliant and beautiful. So I can't thank you enough. I mean, this was such a good reminder for everything that I needed to do. I'm like, oh my God, I you know, and the funny thing is purchased the Psado, sat on it for 6 months, had an assistant work on it. She did nothing for the long time. And then then I had to let her go. And then I was just like, I don't have time for this. And then I just walked away from it all. But it's like, it's just a reminder how powerful some of these things are, because you put in the work to set it up and then mm-hmm. set it and forget it. And it's just really, really good reminder. So I really cannot thank you enough for all of that. Really appreciate it. Thank you.
It's been my pleasure.
Thank you all for taking the time. And I'm going to send an email, including all of us, that Kirsten can send us the link to her inbox Zen, the course for the email. And have a beautiful rest of your weekend.
Thanks so much. Have a great weekend, everyone.
Bye, everyone.